What's up, Jungle Army? It's Inside the Jungle. The Wednesday Night Roundtable is back. This week, I'm joined by Scott Bantel. We'll recap what happened in the big Bengals win over the San Diego Chargers, and we'll look ahead to week three when the Bengals go to Baltimore to take on the Ravens. We'll be joined by Matt Stevens from BaltimoreBeatdown.com and the Baltimore Beatdown podcast to get the inside scoop on what's happening in Baltimore and their 0-2 start. That's all coming up. Plus, your calls. It's the Wednesday Night Roundtable. Let's hit it!
This is Inside the Jungle, episode 213, recorded September 23rd, 2015. Bengals win again.
Video bandwidth for Inside the Jungle is made possible by the support from our Patreon community. To help support Inside the Jungle today, log on to spnt.tv/Patreon.
And welcome into the Wednesday Night Roundtable. The Bengals getting off to a 2-0 start with a big win over the San Diego Chargers. We've got lots to discuss. As we mentioned, they're 2-0, and they've got a big, can I say it any more importantly, a very big game this weekend against the Baltimore Ravens, which we'll be discussing at great length. Glad you could join us. I'm Nick Seuberling, hanging out with my good pal. We've missed him last week. We hope that everything went well with your surgery, Scott Bantel. What's up, Scott?
Nick, I am alive. I'm kicking. It's good to be back. Good to be on the show. Good to have the only wires connected to my ears instead of the rest of my body. So glad to be back on the show.
So what the heck happened?
Well, I had an appendectomy on Wednesday afternoon. So I am partially less of a man now. You have me sans my appendix on the show for the first time. I hope I'm as good without my appendix as I was beforehand.
I'm sure you will be, but that's pretty crazy. Like, it just happened all of a sudden?
Yeah, it was just kind of a stomach started hurting Monday, got worse through the day, got worse through Tuesday, ended up in the ER Tuesday night, the hospital Tuesday and Wednesday night, and went back to work on Monday. So I am back to work, and I am no longer under the influence of pain pills.
Well, that's a bummer.
Yeah, I know.
That might have been more entertaining.
Well, I might have a few extras left, so.
Good. I'm sure we'll talk about that in regards to a couple of issues on Sunday. As we mentioned, the Bengals did win over the San Diego Chargers 24-19. The score was a lot closer than the game really was, if you think about it. If it weren't for a couple of Jeremy Hill fumbles, this game really was quite easily a Bengals win, if you're just looking at the box score. So let's get right into that. Scott, give me your best and worst from Sunday.
Well, I think the worst had to be the Jeremy Hill fumbles. I know, both of them were, that first one, I personally thought his knee was down. And I know when you're getting bent over the pile like he was, it's harder to hold on to the ball. But there just wasn't enough video evidence to overcall what they called on the field. So, but the bottom line is he's got to hold on to football. We've talked about it before on this show. Last year, we've talked about it at the beginning of this year. One of the things that didn't get discussed about him because of how well he played his rookie year was his fumbling issues. He had 5 fumbles last year in 222 carries, which that's a lot. I think it tied for the NFL lead in fumbles, and he was nowhere close to the NFL lead as far as carries go. So it's certainly a concern. And, when you talk about that, I can remember at least once or twice where a fumble was, they ended up overturning it because they said his knee was down, before the, the ball hit the carpet more than 5 times with him last year. So, as good of a back as he is, he's got to start securing that football. Best, you said best too, right?
Yeah.
Best, I will go with, I got to go with Dalton. He's beyond the numbers, he's putting up pretty good numbers right now, but he's just looked comfortable. He looks decisive. He looks like he's seeing the field well. He's making his reads. He hasn't thrown any picks, but he also hasn't had many where you're kind of cringing as he lets it go. I remember that in the past with Dalton. You can almost see it coming. He lets go of that pass and you just know that it's a bad decision. And he hasn't had that, knock on wood, this year. In fact, of his few incompletions, maybe 5 or 6 of them are throwaways. So I think he's finally starting to realize that, hey, you know, living to the next down is better than taking a stupid chance and maybe getting picked off. So I think he's been the real highlight so far through the first 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's hard to argue that. If I had to give a best and worst, I'll start with my worst. Obviously, it's got to be Jeremy Hill. Here's a guy who we thought was going to be one of the best rushers in the NFL this year. And so far through two games, he's just not getting the job done. And, you know, coughing the ball up twice like he did. Obviously, he's in Marvin's doghouse for the time being. We saw it a year ago when he fumbled in that Browns game when they were getting destroyed. And he was really their only bright light that night. Well, he fumbled and, you know, it took him a while to get back into the game, and it took him a while to get some trust from the head coach again. So you can't turn the ball over like you did. It's hard to be hard on Jeremy on the first one. You're right, because when you're bending, you're getting bent in a weird spot like that. Yeah, and by the way, we should be thankful that he didn't significantly get injured on that play. Right. I mean, we've seen players with really bad knee or ankle injuries. Thank God he got up and walked off the field and was able to continue playing, because it did not look good on that play. So I guess I understand the fact that he fumbled that ball, but on the pitch, dude, you got to catch that ball. I mean, it hit him right in the hands.
Right.
And it's not like it was behind him or too far out in front of him. It was right there for him to grab. He just missed it. And that's just unacceptable if you're going to be an NFL running back. So the other thing that I didn't like about it is the fact that, and again, I'm not saying he was moping on the sidelines, but when the game was in the fourth quarter and in crunch time and Giovani Bernard was doing work, like they kept cutting to shots of Jeremy Hill standing on the sidelines, and he just looked like he was unhappy. He looked like he was kind of pouting. And it's not like he probably wasn't. It was just the look. And it didn't look like he was enthusiastic or happy that Gio was doing work. So that's just what I took from it. And I'm probably way off base on it. I'm just basing it on what it looked like on TV. As for my best, you mentioned Andy Dalton. I'm going to give a co-best, and that's Marvin Jones and Tyler Eifert. We knew last year how badly they were missed, and it showed big time on Sunday. Marvin Jones with a big 45-yard touchdown catch, and then, of course, Tyler Eifert, another touchdown catch, giving him 3 on the year. And he had, you know, was our leading receiver again for the second straight week. And it's amazing how much of a difference these two really make. You know, you talk about Andy Dalton looking comfortable back there, Scott. A lot of it has to do with the fact that he can just rely on Tyler Eifert, and he knows where Marvin Jones is going to be. And, you know, if people are going to continue to double cover AJ and take him out of the game plan, it's good to know that he's got weapons elsewhere, whether it's Bernard, who, by the way, we should also make that a best as well. 20 carries for 123 yards. And this is somebody who we thought was on the downhill trend, and we looked really bad in the preseason. And yet here he is back-to-back weeks with really good games on the ground. And so it's tough to give a best, but I'm going to give it to 3 people, actually: Bernard, Eifert, and Jones, because they were fantastic on Sunday.
Yeah. And with Bernard, you know, the thing that got overshadowed with Hill's fumbles is, you know, Bernard's actually running the ball better than Hill is right now. I was taking a look at it last night, and Bernard's averaging, he's got 189 yards. He's averaging 6.6 per carry compared to Hill, who's only averaging 3.5 per carry right now. So, you know, as a runner, he's being more effective right now, you know, fumbling issues aside. So that's a good best, Nick. I agree with you. He had a great game.
I know he's had some good games as a Bengal, but 20 carries for 123 yards. And a lot of it was just really good runs, and he had good vision, good cutbacks. You know, there are still a couple screen plays that they kind of telegraph, and defenses are really keying in on, and they're catching on quite easily. I mean, we saw it a week ago in Oakland. It seemed like every time he was catching a pass, the Raiders were on it. You know, the Ravens will be on it too. For as much film as they've studied over the Bengals the last 2 years, you know, that's going to be the case as well. But I just love the fact that for somebody who had such a bad year last year, by his standards, after his rookie year, I'm really pumped to see Giovani get going in the ground game, because I think that's going to be huge. And we can't just rely on Jeremy Hill. And if he's going to keep fumbling the football, well, you know,
I'm glad we have somebody else back there that can handle the load in a case like this. So good overall weekend from the Bengals. Look, it's 2-0 and they're sitting pretty. You know, Baltimore's 0-2. The Steelers are 1-1. The Browns are 1-1. So I would say that the 2-0 record is a pretty good start. And I think if you look at what we all kind of predicted before the season, we all thought it would be 2-0. And sure enough, that's what's happened.
Yeah, and I think it's really important that they got the 2-0 because I was, you know, if you take a look at their upcoming schedule, you know, things start getting pretty dicey here. They got in their next five games, they got games at Baltimore, at Pittsburgh, and then they have the Chiefs, the Seahawks, and fifth game escapes me. But is it at Buffalo? Maybe
it's Buffalo. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I was gonna say their next five games are all very tough games. So I think getting out to that 2-0 start, that fast start, is very important because these next five games, I think if you come out 3-2, you got to consider that to be a pretty successful five game run through this stretch.
Speaking of fumbles, how about Jamal Charles last Thursday? Oy.
Oy.
At least we're not the Chiefs, right?
Yeah, well, he's on my fantasy team, so I was well aware of his fumbles last Sunday. But lucky for him, he was not the reason I lost. It was a combination of full team suckage.
Well, I want to get back to this Chargers game. You know, obviously, the score I personally thought was closer than the box score really dictated. You know, Philip Rivers was solid. I mean, that guy, it just seems like he might complete the best percentage of passes year in and year out in the NFL. And that, I don't know how he does it with that quirky motion that he's got, but he does it. He finds guys and they get open for him. 21 of 27. The good news is he only threw for 241 yards, which was like, what, 100 yards less than what he did a week before against Detroit. I was disappointed.
Yeah, like 45 came on that busted coverage by Kirkpatrick on that long touchdown.
Exactly. You just took the words right out of my mouth. That's the one outside of the fumbles, which obviously we would be very disappointed about. That was probably the biggest disappointment from Sunday, is seeing Dre get beat like that. I think he was expecting help over the top, and it just didn't happen. And Floyd got behind him. That was probably, from a defensive standpoint, Scott, probably the only big issue I had from Sunday.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at that play, I don't think that was Dre Kirkpatrick's fault. I think what it was is, I think he was releasing him to Reggie Nelson, and it looked like Nelson bit and came in. I think it was Ladarius Green was running a route over the middle, and it looked like Rivers pulled Nelson in with his eyes, and Kirkpatrick lets him go to Nelson. Nelson is kind of coming forward to Green, and that's what resulted in that play. That whole defensive drive, that series was a little disappointing to me. I felt like the defense thought the game was over. And that whole drive, I felt like there was just a little bit of a lack of intensity, kind of culminating with that blown coverage at the end. But, I mean, you're right. Overall, I thought it was a solid defensive game. I'm not going to say it was great. I thought the tackling was really poor, especially at the beginning. Melvin Gordon really got some big runs on him. So you'd like to see them shore that up, especially the tackling issues. But, you know, overall, I think that's a good offensive team that they played. And to hold them to, 19 points, and like you said, I don't think the score indicated how well the Bengals controlled that game for the majority of the afternoon. So I'd say it was a good defensive showing.
Philip Rivers, he did have the two touchdowns. He had the interception late. Good job by Vinny Ray picking that ball off. He also had a fumble that came after one of the Bengals turnovers. I believe it was the first Jeremy Hill fumble. So, fortunately, out of the two turnovers that the Bengals had, the Chargers did nothing with it. So that's a good sign too. But, you know, I look at Melvin Gordon's number, 16 carries, 88 yards. That's actually pretty decent. They did a good job containing Woodhead for the most part. But he's dangerous in the pass game. We saw that in the, he had six catches for 68 yards. He was their leading receiver on the day. And he's a shifty guy. But you're right, the tackling was not great. Your leading tackler for the Bengals for the second straight week is Adam Jones, according to these stats from ESPN. 9 total tackles for Adam Jones. So
yeah,
that's back-to-back weeks. He's our leading tackler.
Yeah, and you don't want to see that. You don't want to see that any leading tackler being in the secondary, because that means that, you know, people are getting past that first level. So, you know, like I said, I thought the defense shored up, the run defense shored up as the game went on, but those first couple drives, they were letting Melvin Gordon pick up some pretty good chunks on some runs, especially with cutback runs. I thought Vinny Ray, he had the nice play at the end of the game, but I thought overall his game on Sunday was less than average. I thought a lot of the long runs were either him picking the wrong gap or, you know, not containing Gordon on the cutback. So you would like to see that get shored up a bit, because I would imagine that Baltimore's going to try to run the ball a bunch this weekend as well.
And again, we're nitpicking here about a 24-19 Bengals win, and a win that's in the AFC conference. So that helps them as far as tiebreakers go down the road. But we're nitpicking here when we're complaining about our kicker missing a field goal. You know, the 36-yard chip, and that's a chip shot for Nugent. I was very surprised to see him miss that kick.
Yeah, it was definitely disappointing, because that you know, that changes, you know, those last couple drives where it ended up getting to be a bit of a nail biter. He makes that kick, and it's a different story at the end of the game. So that's, you know, that was frustrating. But you mentioned a good win over San Diego. That's a team where if they don't win the division, they're likely competing for a wild card spot with. So that gives the Bengals the tiebreaker over the Chargers, which is huge. So while it's not a division win, it's likely a team that they could be battling for a playoff spot with. And so to get the win over them, that is big.
I know it wasn't why we drafted him in the first place, but it was good to see Jake Fisher with a big catch and rumble for 31 yards. He looked like the fastest tackle I've ever seen out there.
He looked good out there, Danny. I was thinking when I saw that play that Dennis Rowland somewhere was quite jealous that the ball finally went to the tackle eligible number 74 on the Bengals, and it wasn't Rowland who got to finally make a catch.
He looked good. So he did have a catch, and I'm sure we're going to see more of that this year. But yeah, Jake Fisher can now say he's caught a ball in the NFL, and that's kind of cool as well. Just some other notes from this game. You know, Marvin Jones, your second leading receiver, two catches for 48, obviously 45 of that coming on the big touchdown catch, which was a beautiful play, a great throw, and a good read by Andy Dalton as well on that play. AJ Green comes in with three catches for 45. And I was actually on my way to my son's soccer game trying to avoid Twitter and didn't want any spoilers when I saw your tweet, Scott, that said AJ Green making up for that drop in the end zone a week ago. So at that point, I was like, all right, AJ Green caught a touchdown. Yeah. So thanks for spoiling it, even though you had no idea. But no, that was a good, and that was a really great catch by AJ, getting both feet down in the back of the end zone like that.
It was, and that's, you know, I bang on AJ a lot, and I'll bang on him probably later on in the show, but, you know, it's those plays that make you see that guy that can be that elite receiver, you know, that is a top five receiver, and it's what makes it so frustrating when he drops those easy passes like he did in the end zone in Oakland. You know, it's what makes those extra frustrating, is because you know the type of skills the guy has. You know, he can make those great plays and make them look so easy, and then he drops the, you know, the easy passes, and it's just, you know, it's something where I think Hugh needs to certainly work with him on, because as great as it is to see those great catches, we need to see less of the mistakes on the easy ones.
Yeah, that's for sure. And there was a play there down near the goal line where he just kind of quit on what looked like a screen play. He's lucky that the defender didn't catch it and go the other way.
Well, he's very lucky, because that ended up being the they scored the game winning touchdown a few plays later. And you know, if that guy intercepts that ball, we may be talking about a loss today. So he's very lucky, and he could have stopped that defender from making a play on the ball. And that's what irritates me about Green. And I don't think it's rarely that it's not picked up a bunch amongst the media, and I'm not sure why, but he's done that so often where he cost Dalton interceptions because of his refusal to fight for a 50-50 ball like that. He just gives up. And He's very lucky that didn't cost them that game.
He's very lucky, but again, he made up for his drop in Oakland with a big touchdown catch, the first of the game and his first of the season. And again, Bengals win 24-19 over the Chargers. They're now 2-0 and climbing up those power rankings. If you're looking around some of the different websites, I've seen them as high as 4. And yeah, they're doing really well, and people are starting to take notice. I saw Andy Dalton was on the NFL Network today, or NFL Live on ESPN. Marvin Lewis was on the NFL Network tonight. So they're starting to get some pub, which is probably a bad sign as they head into a big week in Baltimore as they take on the Ravens. Well, speaking of the Baltimore Ravens, why don't we get a firsthand look and a firsthand account of what's happening out in Baltimore. We're joined by Matt Stevens from BaltimoreBeatdown.com. Matt, hey, thanks for joining us here on Inside the Jungle.
Oh, thanks for having me, guys.
And so you and the Ravens, well, not necessarily you, but your Ravens, are off to a rough start here in 2015. Talk about what's happening and why are they 0-2?
Well, you know, obviously the first game of the season for the Baltimore Ravens was in Denver against Peyton Manning and Gary Kubiak's offense. So, you know, some of that was kind of be expected on the first game. I think a lot of Ravens fans didn't exactly have that penciled in as a win. Yeah, it's Peyton Manning at the start of the season when he's the healthiest he's going to be this season, and behind a pretty decent offensive line and a top five defense for sure. So, you know, the Ravens kind of put in a good effort, but ultimately weren't able to go ahead and claw one out in the opening series. The second game against the Oakland Raiders, that's the shock, I think, for a lot of Ravens fans. Most people kind of expected that to be a good win going into, say, you know, into the Cincinnati game. Hopefully 1-1. Hopefully 2-0, really. But sadly, Derek Carr and Amari Cooper just kind of lit up the Ravens' secondary and was able to seriously put the Ravens behind 10 points at a few different moments of the game before the Ravens were able to get a good turnover and kind of start marching back. Sadly, a end-of-game interception by Joe Flacco kind of sealed the deal, but there was only 26 seconds left on the clock anyway. So, you know, the Ravens kind of flip-flopped on what they did week one, week two. Week one, they put in a solid defensive effort, getting a pick six. Week two, the defense just stunk it up while the offense put up 33 points.
So the defense is a big question going into this game against the Bengals. I want to go back to that game against Oakland. Now, you know, the week before, the Bengals handled Oakland pretty easily. I'm curious, you know, we didn't see it an entire game from Derek Carr. So we you know, we faced the Raiders with Matt McGloin. And that's no knock on Matt McGloin, but he's no Derek Carr. So was this a case of maybe Baltimore being a little too confident after what the Bengals did in week one? Or is this a case of we aren't really sure who the Raiders are? And maybe Baltimore's got some issues on defense that got uncovered by the Raiders.
I think it's the latter of those two. Obviously, Derek Carr and Amari Cooper are teaming up to be an excellent combination for the Raiders, and they look like a good series of guys to build a franchise on. But the Ravens have some issues in their secondary. Ladarius Webb is not able to keep up any longer, and sadly, all those injuries from all those years are starting to kind of creep in with the age to limit him severely in what he's able to do. Add that into just a lot of confusion in the secondary. Guys kind of looking at each other with, you know, shrugging shoulders and wondering what was going on and where they were supposed to be. It led to the Raiders putting up 351 passing yards on the Ravens. So not exactly a great day out of the secondary. Some of it is obviously Derek Carr being there, but some of it is, I think the Ravens are still trying to find their identity, especially on defense with Terrell Suggs being out.
Yeah, Matt, great to meet you in person. That was actually going to be where I was going to go with my next question, was with Terrell Suggs out. The defense looked like they played very well week one against Peyton Manning and the Broncos. Not so much week two. Can that all be chalked up to the loss of Suggs, with the lack of pressure, getting the secondary exposed, or was there more at play than just the loss of Suggs in week two?
I think it was a lot more than just the loss of Suggs. Now, obviously, that doesn't help anything. You're missing one of the better pass rushers and edge setters in the league in Terrell Suggs. So you have to kind of find a combination of players to fill that gap. And the Ravens weren't exactly able to do that They weren't able to get good pressure against Derek Carr, which allowed him to kind of carve up the secondary. In addition to that, the secondary just looked lost. You know, from a week one performance in which they rattled Peyton Manning, both with quarterback pressure and in the secondary, they weren't able to do either one of those things week two. And I'm not entirely sure why, but it's my guess is it's probably more schematic and trying to figure out how to deal with the loss of Terrell Suggs than necessarily the actual loss of Terrell Suggs.
We've got a question from one of our listeners in the chat room. His name's Tony. Matt, he says, what is the Ravens offense like? Is it run heavy, pass heavy? What's going on with the offense right now?
Right now, there's a solid balance for the Ravens, both run and pass. It's the run has not been as good as it was last season. I believe the Ravens had probably about a 4.3 yard carry this season. So it's not great. It's not terrible either. But the biggest thing is that the Ravens are able to kind of get the quick passing game going with Steve Smith and Kamar Aiken, and then obviously Crockett Gilmore, the second-year tight end. The Ravens have been able to be a little bit more efficient and more effective with their pass than they have in years past. So you're kind of starting to see the Ravens pass to set up the run because the run's not working so well, where in years past it was run to set up the pass. So it's a slight difference from what you're probably used to over the last few years. But I'd say realistically, it's the same old offense. They're going to try to pound it down your throat. They're going to try to, you know, beat you up at the line of scrimmage and wear you down throughout the game, and then hopefully go ahead and put some points in on the fourth quarter.
As far as the run game goes, we've seen Gary Kubiak in the years he was there with Baltimore try to employ that zone read, that zone blocking type scheme, and you know you find a hole and then you make your cut and then you go. What's as far as the run game goes, what kind of differences can we see under a new offensive coordinator this year for the Ravens?
Well, Mark Trestman came out early in the offseason and said, look, I'm not going to make any changes. The offense works. I'm just going to add some new wrinkles. So what we're seeing is pretty much the same exact offense that we saw last season. The only difference now is the offensive line is being a little bit shaky. Marshall Yanda is still really good. Jeremy Zutas is still doing his job. And Kelechi Osemele, all three of them are doing just great. It's the outside tackles. Eugene Monroe got injured in the first game with a concussion and has been out and is even questionable for this game at this point. And then right tackle Ricky Wagner, after a good rookie season, he's been getting exposed a little bit at times. So you're kind of seeing the edges crumble in on the Ravens when they're trying to run the ball. So it's resorted to the Ravens kind of stretching it out a little bit more and using their big-bodied wide receivers to try to run the ball outside at times, which has worked, and it worked well against Oakland in a few different third and fives where they got big yardage off the run. But, yeah, it's slightly different than what you guys have seen in the past, and the fact that the Ravens, they're still going to try to beat you up front, but they're not doing so well on the edges.
Hey, Matt, I was thinking about this today with the Ravens starting 0-2 and with the Bengals at 2-0. Do you get the sense from Harbaugh and the players that, you know, they feel like this game is it's only week three, but, you know, going down three in the division would be tough. Does this feel like a must win for the Ravens?
I think it absolutely is, and the Ravens have kind of done a little bit in terms of that. Harbaugh came on and did a nice big diatribe about how this is a tough game and how the Ravens need to go ahead and show some resiliency and kind of come back from an 0-2 start. They're even looking at maybe not continuing with their staying out on the West Coast like they did through the first 2 weeks later on in the season when they have to go back out there. So they're definitely struggling and scrambling to figure out what the world's going on and how to right the ship. I think just from a stats standpoint, there's few teams. I don't think there's any team that has gone 0-3 and gone to the playoffs. I mean, at this point, 0-2, the Ravens are 12% chance to go to the playoffs. So certainly going down 0-3 and one of those games being a division loss would all but kind of sink the Ravens season.
Yeah, no doubt. One of the questions I had with, through the years, even in the years when the Ravens had been really good under Harbaugh, it seems like there's one game each year that they either lose or nearly lose to a team that that really they have no business losing to. And you know, Oakland, I think, is a good example this year. Is there a reason? You know, is it just a matter of playing down to the level of competition at times, or what is it with this team that they sometimes struggle with those weaker opponents?
You know, I oddly enough, I could not tell you what in the world's going on in that instance. I don't think the Ravens could tell you what's going on in that instance. It does seem that one time a year, the Ravens lose to a Jaguars, they lose to a Raiders, they lose to Cleveland, and it's completely astounding why. These are teams that they should pretty easily beat up on, and we saw that last season against Tampa Bay. The Ravens put on a clinic at scoring touchdowns in the first half, but then, you know, weren't so great against the Tennessee Titans. So I'm guessing that it's probably just the Ravens playing down to their competition at times and maybe thinking that they're going to do better, and just concentration issues. Guys that, you know, like Steve Smith not being able to catch the ball properly and end up losing some of those games. I think it's probably that more so than is just schematically they don't match up well against these teams. But I'm not entirely sure. I mean, Coach Harbaugh does not seem like the type of coach that would let these players get complacent or overestimate their own ability against a team. So I don't know. I mean, it could be that, or it could be just the team just doesn't match up against certain teams very well, but there seems to be no good pattern to it one way or another.
Yeah, it's just weird because they seem to be such a good big game team. You know, when they play the other top teams, they seem to always show up and play well. So it's always just surprising when, you know, you see them against a team where you think they should just easily walk over, to see them struggle is always surprising.
Yeah, it's you know, it happens like you said about once a season where the Ravens just put up a weird goose egg against a team that they shouldn't. And can't get things kind of rolling. And it very well could be just like you mentioned, that the team is much better with its back against the wall. It's much better in the playoffs. It's much better when the games actually matter, I guess. And not to say regular season doesn't matter, but at the end of the season in the playoffs, those games are crucial. And the Ravens seem to turn it on when the colder weather starts coming in and when those games really start to matter. So maybe it is just that us versus them mentality that the Ravens have had since Coach Billick has been around.
Yeah.
All right, Matt. Well, we'll get you out of here on this. Give us a score prediction and what's going to happen on Sunday when these two AFC North teams match up.
Oh, I'm going to say it's going to be 23 Ravens, 21 Bengals. The Ravens are able to kind of right their ship at home and able to use that home cooking that the Ravens are so famous for, to go ahead and beat up on the Bengals and kind of get their head straight before going on to finishing 10-6 for the season. I think with AJ Green at this point kind of dinging up his knee and not being sure if he's going to be even able to play, or if he is able to play, be 100%, I think the Ravens are able to use their secondary to kind of hold down the Bengals and get after Andy Dalton and make him make some mistakes.
Well, we'll see what happens this week. A big game on Sunday between the Ravens and the Bengals. Matt, if people want to check you out, where can they find you?
You can go ahead and visit me at BaltimoreBeatdown.com. That's the SB Nation site, Baltimore Beatdown. Or you can go ahead and check me out on Twitter at @MattStevens_Bolt. Excuse me, Matt S.
Did you forget for a second?
I totally did. Just visit us at BeMoreBeatdown. On Twitter, that's the easiest way to do it. Facebook, we're Baltimore Beatdown. And check out our podcast. We do a Thursday podcast at 7 p.m. Eastern.
That's awesome. And I just subscribed to it tonight. I'm really looking forward to tuning in. So, Bengals fans, if you want the inside scoop on the Ravens, you got to check out the Baltimore Beatdown podcast as well. Matt Stevens, appreciate the time. And we'll talk, I'd imagine, sometime soon.
Absolutely.
Keep up the good work, Matt.
Thank you, guys.
That's Matt Stevens from BaltimoreBeatdown.com. We certainly thank him for stopping by the program this week. Good stuff from him, right, Scott?
Oh, no doubt. I've traded questions with Matt in the past for our Behind Enemy Lines segment on the site. I'm actually going to be trading questions with one of his writers that'll go up, I think, on Friday this week. So a good guy. They do a good job over there at Baltimore Beatdown. So if you're looking for get some insight on the Ravens. Good, great place to go.
All right. Well, we've done it. We've made these guys hold on long enough. We'll open up the phone lines. If you want to get in touch, the number is, of course, it would help if I had the number in front of me. Oh, here. 513-657-2807. It's a new number, and I have to get used to it. I got to learn the new number. Again, 513-657-2807 is the number. Let's welcome in area code 859. Hi, who's this? 859, you're on the air. Let's try this again. Let me unmute the channel first. 859, you're on the air.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Hey, we can hear you, John. What's up, man?
Hey, okay. Well, we did good last Sunday. We're 2-0. Team's looking strong. Hill having those fumbles had me a little bit nervous, but we still won the game. And hopefully we'll do better this next Sunday. What do we need to do to beat Baltimore? I know they haven't looked good so far, but, you know, it's what happens Sunday that we have to worry about. It's in Baltimore. It's a divisional game. What do we need to do to win?
Scott, why don't you start us off?
Well, I think number one is limiting the running game. I think Joe Flacco really excels when the run game's going and he can use the play action pass. So I think, you know, containing Forsett right off the start and, you know, kind of making them one dimensional. I think making Flacco have to beat them with what I see as a weak wide receiving core and against a strong Bengals secondary, I think would be the way the Bengals would like to play this one out.
I think for me, John, you can't turn the football over. Don't give Baltimore more opportunities to beat you. So if you're Jeremy Hill and you're carrying the rock, hold on to it this time.
Yeah, I agree with that. Hill definitely has to keep hold of the football. Overall, the team's looking, you know, really good this year, and, you know, we just take it one game at a time. I do think we can come out of Baltimore with a win. You know, now last year we were just going right down the field on Baltimore, and I'm talking about the game in Baltimore. You know, the first game of the season, that game should have been about a 40-point blowout.
Yep.
Eifert got hurt, and that hurt us. But you were saying earlier in the podcast, you know, just how much of a difference Eifert and Marvin Jones make. And, you know, I couldn't agree more. Dalton is just so much more confident. The team is just better all the way around with those two players on the field. A.J. Green, he's a good player, but, you know, without those other two, you're still fairly limited as long as, you know, the other team, double teams, A.J. Green and whatnot. But that's not able to happen with, you know, Eifert and Jones out there. So I think we'll get a win on Sunday. I think we need to play really good defense. I'd get after Flacco some too, I think. And, you know, with Terrell Suggs out, he tore his Achilles the first game of the season out in Denver. You know, they don't have much of a pass rush. And if you're not going to rush Dalton, at least in these past two games, you're in for a long day. Hopefully we'll see that on Sunday. And that's all I got for tonight, guys. I'm just going to say hooday and let some other people talk, okay?
All right, appreciate the call, John, and thanks for holding.
All right, hooday.
Hooday, that's John from Kentucky here on the podcast. Let's go to, let's try area code 513. Hi, who's this?
Greg from Cincinnati. How y'all doing?
Hey, Greg, how you been, buddy?
You know, hanging in there, bud. You know, just taking it game by game, but I tell you what, you know, like that one guy said, it's just when you got Eifert and Jones back, and you know, you look at last year, people keep forgetting. Some people may forget Sanu was our number one target last year. No disrespect towards Sanu. He was never number one, and you never heard Sanu's name called at all this year, you know?
You're right. We haven't. He did have a catch on Sunday, one catch for 15 yards. He was only targeted twice. And probably if Andy Dalton had thrown that ball a little bit better in the corner of the end zone, he might have had a touchdown catch. But you're right. We haven't heard his name called very much. And that, you know, and that's because of Eifert and because of Marvin Jones.
Exactly. And you look at that defensive line, you know, it's like what everybody's saying, all the coaches, what the defense coordinator was saying. Geno's starting to, is now really coming back to his old self. You can tell he's clogging up that line. And Phillip Rivers, let's just say he's not an easy guy to bring down. He's a big guy, kind of like Big Ben is, you know. Michael Johnson, all having him. I know he did. Dunlap. You look at Will Clark got a sack. And think of this. Think how good our defense is getting better. and you look at our, and you look at people criticize Leon Hall and the defensive backs. What amazes me about the defensive backs is when a guy catches the ball or something, the way how they tackle to prevent them from getting more yards, like if it's a screen pass, like it just amazes me how physical all of our defensive backs are tackling wise too.
Yeah, you're right. Dre and Adam Jones have no fear when it comes to making tackles in the screen game and in the run game. And you're right. I love the fact that Geno Atkins had three hits on the quarterback on Sunday. Dunlap had two. It was a slow start out in Oakland. I was expecting a lot more from our pass rush, but you got to think right. that with the Ravens' offensive line not being that great right now and Flacco not being exactly the quickest quarterback in the world, I'd like to think that they can get pressure on him this weekend.
Exactly. I couldn't agree more with you right there. And think about this. As good as that's going, can you imagine if we get perfect back to all healthy, the way our defensive line is, if you get perfect back to all healthy in later weeks, I mean, that's like a big addition right there. And, you know, our linebackers, I think, are doing okay. Well, so you still guys going to be asking me, and I'm noticing myself, why isn't A.J. Hawk out there much?
That is a good question. That sounds like a Cody Toomey question, the guy who studies all that film, man. Scott, I don't know. I haven't really seen or heard his name called very much this year either.
I think it's just situationally. He was out there a lot more in the Oakland game than he was in San Diego. But it seemed like in San Diego, they were doing a lot of nickel packages where they only had two linebackers on the field, which was a bit surprising to me that they leave Ray Malou out there in those situations because he's terrible in coverage. But you know, he played more in that first game. I think with Hawk, it's going to be kind of week to week, depending on you know, what type of defense they're going to be playing that week.
There you have it, Greg.
Yeah, will do. You know, like I say, with this schedule, I'm just taking it one week at a time. I'm trying not to get – it's hard not to get excited, but, you know, this schedule, you got to take it one game at a time and stuff. You know, it's just one big step after the other.
This weekend is Super Bowl 50, if you're asking me. Just go win against the Baltimore Ravens.
I'm treating every game like Super Bowl 50, man. I'm treating every single game like one.
Yeah. I think it'll be a good game. You know, if it's anything like it was last year out in Baltimore in week one, I think it'll be a good game for the Bengals.
Yeah, let's just pray we do never have a game like the Eagles just had against the Cowboys. I mean, I've seen bad luck happen, but I've never in my life seen any bad luck happen like that with them last weekend, especially when Brandon Weeden comes in at quarterback and throws an easy slam touchdown.
Yeah, let's knock on wood. Yeah. Brandon Weeden has beaten the Bengals before. I don't even want to go there.
Okay, yeah, that's right.
Well, we appreciate the call, Greg. Don't be a stranger, buddy.
I will do. Hooday,
that's Greg from Cincinnati giving us the ring. Let's go to area code 6. Oh, let's try this again. Area code 609. Hi, who's this?
Hey, Nick, it's Josh Schuster from New Jersey.
Hey, what's up, Josh?
Not much. I'm in the process of all the people in my area getting ready for Pope of Devin here.
Oh, nice.
Shutting everything down.
Good stuff.
Yeah. It's funny that there was somebody who called into the Philly Sports Talk radio and was joking and said they're closing down a lot of the bridges. And they said, well, it's probably good with how the Eagles are playing that then you won't have a bunch of fans, you know, jumping off the bridge. They're acting like it's the end of the world. It's kind of funny.
Gotta love Philly,
there's
man.
There's not many times I can say I'm glad I'm a Bengals fan over an Eagles fan, but you were just saying about they have to treat it like it's Super Bowl 50. Don't say anything about that because Marvin Lewis in the playoffs, they don't mix. So let's treat it like it's a Sunday 1 o'clock game, regular season.
I like your thinking.
They'll do better that way.
Yeah, I'm in full agreement with you. Now that you say it that way, yeah, it's a 1 o'clock game in Baltimore, a place where they've won and have had no issues winning there. So yeah, I'm with you. That's a good call, Josh.
I don't ever call in. I think this is only like time number two or three in a couple of years. But I kind of wanted to call in to get something off my chest.
Okay.
And it started with the beginning of the season. And I get my Sports Illustrated NFL preview issue. And it has the Bengals winning six games. And that kind of started the chip on my shoulder. I like try to never have a chip on my shoulder as a fan because there's not really much you can do with it. But I'm like, the team's been in playoffs 4 years in a row. Like, if they're going to take a step back, put them at 8 wins, not 6. But that ticked me off a little bit. And then I have to do the game rewind, and I'm watching the week one game, and the announcers can't get it right. How many times we've been in the playoffs years in a row. I'm like, guys, there's this thing called Google. Use it. It's not hard. It's really not hard. And that really got to me. And for the third week in a row on certain podcasts other podcasts I listen to, they have the Bengals on upset alert. I'm like, guys, really? Like, the Ravens last year kind of figure out how to cover Tyler Eifert. And if I would have told you that A.J. Green has one touchdown catch through two games and doesn't even have 100 yards receiving in either game, it might be hard to believe that the Bengals are 2-0. They're probably thinking that they drop maybe one of the two. This team is good. And Geno is back. I don't understand why they're putting us on upset alert to a team that, to be perfectly honest, really hasn't looked that great. It has been staying out in the West for days. That has to come back. I don't know. It's just a little bothersome.
Well, let me ask you this, Josh. If the Ravens were to beat the Bengals this Sunday, would you consider it an upset? Because I wouldn't. Even if they are 0-2 and we're 2-0, I don't consider that an upset because it's an AFC North division game, and these games are always tight. So to me, that wouldn't even really be an upset. But I don't think they're going to lose the Ravens. I think they're going to handle them quite easily.
I would call it an upset, but to put them on upset alert, I think it is a little bit too much. Like, my favorite Bengals win was last year, week one in Baltimore on Ray Lewis Day, where they unveiled that statue of him doing that ridiculously foolish dance he did before every game and having Ravens fans leave in the third quarter because their team is losing by so much. That's one of my favorite wins they've ever had. And if they were able to do it last year, I don't see any way that they lose this game. I don't think it's going to be a blowout, but I don't think you can put them on upset alert when you look at how the two teams have played.
Yeah.
But anyway, I'll let you get some other calls, but just wanted to, lift the chip off my shoulder and set it down somewhere. So.
Well, we're glad we have a platform for you to get things off your chest, Josh, and we appreciate your support. And hey, this is what we're here for. We're here to talk about the Bengals, and I know you live in Philly, so you can't really do that. So this is the perfect opportunity for you. So we're glad we could be here for you, man.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. Hooday.
That's Josh giving us a ring here on Inside the Jungle. We've got 6 phone lines open, Bengals fans. If you're watching us live here at cincyjungle.com, 513-657-2807 is the number to call. So we heard from Matt Stevens from Baltimore Beatdown a minute ago, Scott. Give me your take on the 0-2 Ravens. What's been really hampering them here so far in 2015?
Well, I mean, I'd say a couple things. The first game was not a game I expected them to win. I actually didn't expect it to be that close. I with the way Manning was playing, I think that game came close, but the Ravens' only touchdown was on a pick six that, quite frankly, if you watch it, was pass interference. Jimmy Smith really ran through the receiver. I still don't get that one. But, the second game was the head scratcher. I expected them, even without Suggs, to handle Oakland pretty soundly. But like we talked about with Matt, is oddly enough, this team, as good as they are in big games, against teams they should handle easily, for whatever reason, they struggle. They did it last year where they barely beat Cleveland in a must-win game. I think defensively, I think some of it's learning to play without Suggs. Suggs certainly was their best, at least I think their best player on defense. the pressure he could put on the quarterback makes their secondary better. I mean, any quarterback that doesn't have time to throw, you know, the secondary is going to be the beneficiary of that. And, you know, so losing Suggs, that's a hard guy to replace. But also, he seems to be their emotional leader on that side of the football. You know, since Ray Lewis retired, it seems like that baton passed to Terrell Suggs. And he just seems like one of those guys that really gets that defense up, gets them going, and really gives them that swagger, if you will. And I think without him, that defense is a little bit lost right now. And I think you saw that last week when a guy like Derek Carr had probably his best game in the NFL against a team that you wouldn't have expected it to come against. You know, offensively, as he mentioned at the start of the season, the Ravens, you know, I ranked the Ravens as the top offensive line based off what they did last year. And they're certainly not playing to that level right now. And when you have an offensive line that's struggling, one, you know, you have a quarterback that doesn't have time and hence struggles. And two, the run game struggles, which then results in, you know, the passing game struggling. So they're kind of all related. And I think their issues are on the line on both sides of the ball. You know, the loss of Suggs is hurting that defensive line, in turn hurting the secondary, and their offensive line not playing up to par right now is hurting the run game. Now their pass game was solid against Oakland. You know, overall, I just think talent wise, this team just, they don't have the talent that the Bengals have, and offensively, they don't have the talent the Steelers have. So I still see this team, healthy or not healthy, as the third best team in this division. So, you know, I think the Bengals are the better team. I think they're playing better, and it would be great to get a win, because I do think that a win this weekend would actually bury the Ravens as far as the division goes.
Yeah, I think, you know, it'll be hard to come back from an 0-3 deficit to start the year, especially when you consider they've got two games still against the Steelers. And, you know, we've seen them struggle with the Browns as well in years past. I'll give my take on the Ravens here in a minute. Let's welcome in, though, our good buddy Fatal Content on our Skype line. Fatal, what's up, man?
Hey, what's going on, gentlemen? I see you guys are holding it on the fort tonight. Too deep, huh?
Doing the best we can. What's on your mind?
Oh, yeah, I just wanted to make the point about my boy Gio Bernard, man.
Had a feeling he might do that.
I called the show a few weeks ago and said no worries at all about this gentleman, that this guy was going to step up and he was going to do what he had to do. And he did it in a big way this weekend. Did I see him doing it that way in one game, 120, and Hill getting sat? Of course not, but I had a feeling he'd do it in some capacity, either receiving or running. And, man, the guy stepped up, man. He did a huge this big past
game.
Weekend.
Yeah, he had a huge game. And, you know, he had a good first game against the Raiders as well, 8 carries for 63 yards. So you're right. And, you know, I think the big key for Bernard, and I'm sure you would agree with this, Fatal, is the fact that he's actually healthy. You know, it was obviously, we talked about it last week with Jay Morrison from the Dayton Daily News. You know, Bernard getting banged up like he did a year ago in Indy, that's tough to recover from. And so I think that's why you saw a little bit of a downhill slide from him a year ago. This year, he's healthy. He's got a lead blocker in Hewitt who's doing things, and he's got one of the best offensive lines in the NFL. So, yeah, it's about time we've seen it. We were just kind of wondering where it went.
Yeah, exactly. Through two games, he has 189 yards and a 6.6 yard average. He's running in between tackles and he's making guys miss at the second level. So, yeah, like you say, but last year, I think Andy Dalton kind of set him up that game to get murdered twice, two hits that were hellacious in one season, let alone one game. But I think that was a pretty great by Gio. I also want to give a little credit to that secondary, man. If you look at what they've done to individuals that have killed it, if you look at Keenan Allen, he had the week prior to playing us, 15 catches for 166. And against us, I believe he had 2 for 16, man. That's a shutdown job. And Amari, just last week, we shut him down. And this past weekend that came, I think he had, I believe it was like 7 catches for 109 yards. So, I mean, he killed it. And we completely shut that guy down the first week. Mind you, he's a rookie, but, I mean, you see what he can do this past weekend. So, D. Smith had 10 for 150 against the Raiders. So, if we shut him down, this isn't a fluky thing, man. This defense is definitely killing it, man. Now, Geno Atkins, it's good to see myself, Florida kids, waking up and dominating on each side of the ball, man. He is absolutely killing it up the middle.
He's having a good start. I would like to see him get more sacks. But, yeah, he had three quarterback hits on Sunday against Phillip Rivers. What are your thoughts on this Ravens game? Give me a score prediction.
A quick thought would be I kind of disagree with you. I think this would be in seasons prior, maybe, you know, the Ravens have owned us and it wouldn't be an upset. But I think the way the season has started and the Bengals look like a superior team, and I don't think Harbaugh was using hyperbole when he said we were the most talented squad in the NFL. I actually think this year if they beat us, it's an upset. And we can definitely go for the stomp on their throat, so to say, this year if we beat them and send them to 0-3. My score prediction, man, I'm going to say Bengals 26, Ravens 13.
I like it. Doubling up on the Ravens on the road to even better. You got a question of the night for us before we let you go?
Yeah, I'll try to keep it short, man. If you had to put praise for preparation from each unit as a whole, would you give credit to Gunther for shutting down Allen and Amari after seeing how they gashed opponents? Or would you say Hugh for his solid game plans and having the offense being efficient and prolific? I mean, obviously both have contributed as a whole, but which unit are you most impressed with so far?
Scott, start us off.
Well, I think they both look good through 2 weeks. If I was going to give it to one, I'd give it to Hugh in the offense. I think he's been creative, but not in a stupid creative way. You know, he's showing a lot of looks, but they're plays that are working. And, you know, I think the biggest thing with the offense this year is whether it's Hugh or just his development is Andy Dalton. I mean, like we said earlier in the show, for the first time in 4 years, it feels like Dalton looks comfortable back there. It looks like things have slowed down a bit for him. He looks decisive. He seems to be making good reads. And when things aren't there, you know, he scrambles or just throws it away and goes on to the next down. So, you know, I think some of that has to do with Hugh as the offensive coordinator. So I'd say Hugh.
And I'm going to lean the other way. I'm going to go with Paul Gunther. Consider where this defense was a year ago, Fatal. They were not good, right? We were getting a Geno Atkins who was coming off of reconstructive knee surgery. We didn't have Burfict for a large part of the year. Leon Hall was aging rapidly. They still had an aging Terrence Newman as one of the other starting cornerbacks. And, you know, they really struggled a year ago. They couldn't turn the football over. They couldn't get any pressure on the quarterback. And now here we've got a healthier Geno Atkins. We get Michael Johnson back in the fold. I'm not saying that Michael Johnson's had the greatest start to the season, but again, he's also coming off a knee injury. Carlos Dunlap's re-energized. I think what they've done defensively the first two games has been even more impressive when you consider the year that Gunther had last year. I know they went up against a Raiders team that was not great, and we faced their backup quarterback for a good portion of that game. But even when Derek Carr was in there, it wasn't like he was moving them down the field. His throws were high. They were off target. And so for me, I'm going to go with Gunther. I think what they've done the first 2 weeks against both of these teams was really impressive. And I'm really looking forward to see where this defense continues to go once they get, you know, guys back, you know, people like Burfict. Once you fill him in, this defense can go a long way.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Great answer by both of you guys. I don't think you could go wrong with either one, but I kind of will lean towards the offense myself because, like you said, the defense is doing well, but, you know, they'll clean up a few things. Maybe the tackling from the linebackers has been a little suspect for the most part, but I will say the offense, man, for Dalton to go 41-60 for nearly 500 yards, 5 touchdowns, no interceptions, no fumbles, no sacks. I think that's very impressive. So like you said, it's great that both units are making it a race, but I'd have to give the slight edge to the offense, man.
And not only that with Dalton, and this is where I'll give some credit to Hugh and Andy Dalton, but all 41 of his throws have been good reads, right? There haven't been those throws where we're thinking, oh my gosh, what were you thinking? Why did you throw it there? Kind of throws where that almost nearly get picked off or, we're not good reads. So I'm with you there. I see it's hard to praise. If you had to pick one, I'm going defense. That's just my take.
Yes, yes, sir. Great answer, man. You guys are we're great tonight. Great interview on that call. And keep holding down the fort, man. And I will say, man, let's be the big brothers, man. Let's stomp on the little brothers when we get a chance to and show them that in the AFC we're a force, because the Colts and everybody else is looking shaky. I know it's 2 weeks, but, man, this talent is finally showing itself to come to fruition in terms of results. And I think that we need to kill these guys, man. 0-3. Let's do it.
I hear you, man. Hey, appreciate the call as always, Fatal.
No doubt, man. Who freaking day?
Who day? That's Fatal Content giving us a ring here on our Skype line here on Inside the Jungle. Let's go to area code 336. Hi, who's this?
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Brian in Greensboro, North Carolina.
Hey, Brian, what's on? What's going on, man? Thanks for calling in. Thanks for holding.
Nothing much. Huge fan of the show. Glad I found it a couple of weeks ago. Been looking online for Bengals content, living here in the Tar Heel State, born and raised in Cincinnati, so it's good to see people talking about the Bengals, looking for that kind of content all the time.
Awesome. Well, we appreciate you calling in. I know we've got a good good friend of us, Kurt Airport, Kurt as we call him. He's in Asheville, so he's not too far from you. But yeah, you've got some friends down there in North Carolina country. Don't you worry, Brian.
I have heard him call in, and I would like to catch a beard with him sometime. Good beer down there in Asheville. Anyway, you guys had mentioned the best and worst going into last week. I just wanted to kind of touch base. The big uglies up front really helped out. I mean, obviously, Andy has no sacks on the season, and then Gio has had big holes to run through all year. I think that the offensive line is kind of the unsung hero of this offense right now, really setting the tone, big physical play up front. I just wanted to get your guys' take on that.
The offensive line has been fantastic. And I give and rip on Paul Alexander all the time just because I think I don't know how he still has a job with the Bengals, because it just seems like there's no creativity with the run game. It's always the same power run to the right with the guard pulling, you know, that sort of thing. So for me, I give a lot of flack towards Paul Alexander, but you do have to give him credit with this offensive line. It's obviously easy to coach when you've got people like Whitworth, and, you know, as much as Andre Smith got a lot of heat coming out of college for the way he left Alabama and left the combine, and then he ran without a shirt off, and, you know, he's turned out to be a really good right tackle in this league. So somebody had to coach him. So I guess I got to give Paul Alexander credit there. But the way this offensive line, and Scott, you'd probably agree with this as well, the way they've played here so far in the first 2 weeks has been probably been the biggest key for this offense. I mean, they're keeping Andy Dalton clean. He hasn't had a single sack. He's hardly been touched. You know, the one time he did get touched this weekend, thankfully it was a incomplete pass where Manti Te'o lit him up. But outside of that, that's the only real time that I've seen him get hit, Scott.
Yeah, and anytime you keep your quarterback off the ground, you have a much better chance of winning. So the fact that he hasn't been sacked yet in the first 2 weeks, you know, that helps. You know, it helps the passing game, and you know, like you said, they're opening up holes in the run game. So, you know, I think it all starts up front, offense and defense, with both lines. And right now, I think both lines are playing very well.
Awesome. You got anything else for us, Brian?
Well, you mentioned, again, best and worst. Worst has got to be Jeremy Hill. Yeah. You got to hold on to the ball a little bit better than that, man. We thought that he was going to be a bell cow. I was so unbelievably stoked this year going in with him. And along with you guys, thought that Gio had taken a huge step back. But, I mean, again, I've lived here in North Carolina for 10 years, and my friends here have just sung the praises of Giovani Bernard out of North Carolina. And they are not wrong. This guy can move. And I think that last year we forgot about it. I think that he was way more injured than we were led to believe or that he showed. And I still think that Jeremy Hill is an exceptional back, which really means that this running back duo could be special this year.
I hope you're right. And, you know, it's a good start to Giovani Bernard's season here in 2015. And I'm not going to write off Jeremy Hill just yet, but you're right. You got to hold on to the football, especially the second one where it was a pitch, right? And it hit him right in his hands. I mean, You got to make that play. And I think for the most part, Hill, I think he's pressing a little bit. You know, I think he's put a lot of pressure on himself going into the season to go out there and be the best back in the NFL. And I think he's leaving a lot of yards out there on the field. I think, you know, maybe a good thing for Gio to get going and maybe get Hill some touches here and there and just kind of bring him back down to earth a little bit. Maybe that'll help and get him going again.
I feel the same way. Gentlemen, I'm going to leave you with a who day, and let's get a win against Baltimore. We need to bury him.
I like it. I like your thinking, Brian. And don't be a stranger. Give us a ring again, man.
We'll do it. Thanks, guys.
Who day? That's Brian. Down in North Carolina. Come on and raise up. No, I can't. I'm not doing that again. Wow, that was bad.
that will make the next audio clip, Nick.
Yeah, my buddy in college, he used to do that rap all the time. It was quite funny. Let's see here. Let's try this. Area code 513. Hi, who's this?
Hey, this is James from Cincinnati.
Hey, James, what's up, man?
Not much. I can't talk for long. I just wanted to make sure you guys were giving Bodine his credit. He's played really well this year.
I think he's, you know, he gets a lot of flack too. And I think, you know, he's all part of that offensive line. Everybody up front, all five of them have done a good job. And Bodine, you know, you got to also remember too, this is only his second season. So, yeah, I'm with you. He's got to give him a lot of credit.
It'll be interesting to see if the Baltimore defensive line can do anything, because I don't really think they're any stronger than Oakland's line.
Yeah, and they haven't shown it. I mean, we watched Oakland just move the ball at will in that final drive against Baltimore. I was shocked at how easy, you know, Derek Carr was able to move down the field, and he had almost no pressure in his face. And it was like Baltimore, yeah. I don't know what they were doing, but they just let it happen.
Yeah, my rational football fan doesn't think that next week's or this week's game is going to be that tough. But my Bengals fan says, "Oh, they've lost two games. It's their home opener. The Bengals are looking good." Well, hopefully, you know, the way they're playing, they'll kind of wean us off of that.
All I gotta say is just win, right?
Yep, that's right. I gotta get going. Just wanted to check in with you guys.
Well, appreciate the call, James. We'll talk to you next week, bud.
Sure. Good day.
Good day. Let's go to area code 828. Hi, who's this?
Hey, Nick, it's Asheville, or it's Kurt down in Asheville, North Carolina.
It's airport, Kurt. Did you hear Brian a minute ago? You've got some company down there in North Carolina.
I did. That's why I called in. I had to holler at my boy down in NC. It's been crazy tonight, so I haven't had a chance to really listen, but I heard, I was like, someone's calling from North Carolina. I'm going to have to call in now.
That's awesome. It's good to know you've got some friends down there in the NC. Give me your best and worst of this weekend, Kurt.
Oh, I mean, I don't want to cop out, but I mean, the best has to be Giovani Bernard when he stepped up. It was really nice to see him take the reins when Hill went down. As far as worse, I mean, I guess I would have to say the run defense. I mean, there was too many times when Gordon, you know, like tackles, I guess, you know, the run defense and missed tackles. I mean, it's like, it's an illness we have every year on the line and in the linebacker crew about, you know, one of these quick shifty backs, you know, makes it to the line and all of a sudden one guy misses and then the second guy misses and the running back ends up with another 10 or 15 yards. The tackling is probably going to be the worst.
Yeah, it was tough to watch, and Danny Woodhead is a shifty back. They limited him to about 37 yards on the day, but you're right. Gordon did get free on a couple of those runs, and it looked like we lost some contain out on the outside a couple of times. That was disappointing as well. But you know, it wasn't like he broke anything too big. I mean, he didn't have any touchdowns, Melvin Gordon, and they kept the running backs out of the end zone. But you're right, the tackling. And just the scheme, it seemed like at times wasn't the best for the run defense.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think we're still missing perfect. One of the things I was going to ask about is the linebackers. It's like, I was trying to think, like, perfect isn't in yet. You know, hopefully, you know, he'll be back and ready to rear and go for the Pittsburgh game. And my question was going to be, well, which linebacker do you think has stepped up the most in his absence? And I was trying to think, like, I don't really have one that I thought has really stepped up a huge amount. Like, Ronald Lucas playing okay. Vinny Ray has been playing okay. He had that super awesome interception. But besides that, he's been a pretty average guy. AJ Hawk's not doing anything crazy. And Lenore has actually looked, they all look like very average linebackers, which is why they're going to be against San Diego this weekend, and the missed tackles was just like, oh my gosh, there's another one. Seems like they always, the linebackers just always the first one to miss.
Yeah, you're right. The linebackers, we haven't really seen anything special from them. And I don't know why that is. You know, Maluga, we've seen him miss some tackles. We haven't seen AJ Hawk's name
for years.
Well, right. You're right. But I'm surprised we haven't seen AJ Hawk very much. In fact, when I remember watching the game, I had to watch it on DVR after the fact. And the one time I saw him on the field, I was just like, oh, wow, there's AJ Hawk. Haven't seen, and I had to think about it for a second, like, wow, I don't really ever see him on the field very much.
Yeah, they've got Lemur out a little bit more than I thought they would. I thought that Hawk was probably going to get more starts or more playing time over him. But, I mean, last year, Lemur kind of was like lackluster. We all thought that was going to be like his coming out year. And then when Perfect, you know, was out so much, we're like, well, now he's really going to come out. And he never really did anything to impress.
Yeah,
he's not really doing anything much to impress this year either. But not to talk too much time, I got a funny question for you guys that I want you to think about. And that is, in which game this season will Mohamed Sanu throw his first touchdown bomb to another wide receiver? I'm pretty sure that in previous years, it's been right around week 3. Do y'all think they're going to go to Mohamed Sanu for a long bomb to either A.J. Green or Marvin Jones? Or who knows, maybe even Andy Dalton on a touchdown pass this Sunday?
I like your thinking. Scott, what do you think? Do you think it's possible?
You know, I think it's with the formations that Hugh's been running out, these plays Hugh's been running out, I think it's a great time, especially with the way the Ravens secondary looked last week. Boy, wouldn't it be fun to do it to the Ravens, too. You know, to do it to a division opponent, especially one that's playing so poorly right now. I'll go ahead. I'll say this week.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with you. I think we will see some trickeration from Hugh this week. And Sanu completes a touchdown pass. But I'm going to go even bolder. I'm going to say Tyler Eifert.
Oh, Sanu to Eifert. I'd like that. That'd be good.
Yeah. And then I'll even go even more bold. I'll say Andy Dalton as my option 1B.
Oh, so he's going to do two of them.
No. If it's not Eifert, I'm going to go with Dalton.
Okay. So you're saying it's not going to be dual wide receiver, to tight end or quarterback, or – how about this? I'm gonna up you one more. I'm gonna say it's gonna be Mo Sanu to Fisher. We'll pull a little bit more tackle eligible down there. I know Bantel likes that.
That'll be tough to do. Yeah, I mean, because at that point you've only got what, two receivers in the game if there's a tackle eligible in there. So that'd be tough to do, man. But that would be awesome. I would love to see that.
That'd be great.
Awesome.
All right, I won't bug you too much. I'm going to leave you on a downer, though, which is I keep on thinking of last year when New England came off that really, really bad loss, and we were riding high 3-0 coming off the bye week, and it was just a recipe for us to get a butt whooping. And I have a feeling, and I'm knocking on wood because I hope I'm wrong, but I have a feeling that like Baltimore's going to come out in their home opener, and they're going to. I don't think Baltimore is a pushover any year. And just because they're 0-2 doesn't mean they're not going to get in the mix and give us a run for our money. So I'm thinking this weekend is going to be a tough game, a lot tougher than a lot of people think. And I'm not sure we're going to win this one. I'm going 21-24 Ravens. I'm sorry.
Oh, I think I just hung up on you.
Oh, no.
Hey, man, you're entitled to your opinion. I hope you're wrong, though.
Me too. I hope I'm wrong, too. So, all right, have a good one, night.
You too, Kurt.
Have a good one, guys. Good day.
Appreciate it. That's Kurt down in Nashville, giving us a ring. Airport Kurt here on Inside the Jungle. Let's go to another call. They're flying in tonight, Scott. Area code 937. Hi, who's this?
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Chris and Dayton.
Hey, Chris, what's up, man?
Not much, man. First of all, I got to get out the way that I saw the shade that you threw in my direction a few episodes back where you said, oh, if you call in negative, I'm going to hang up on you. I gotta say that was a response to a tweet I said. I was gonna land base them after a preseason game.
That was I don't know if it was you, but there was a lot of negativity that night on Twitter, man.
Oh man. I had to be one of them. But you know, it's all good. You know, I love you guys. I love what you guys do. But I just have to call in, you know, just to check in, let you guys know I'm paying attention, watching everything that's going on. Of course, I'm watching every Bengals game closely, and of course, everybody else in the AFC North, because I really think we need that division crown to make that next step. I mean, if you think about it, it's all well and good that we're doing well this early in the season. You know, we got out to a nice 2-0 start. We beat one of the heavy contenders in the AFC last Sunday. I love that. But I think this team, ultimately what it comes down to is what we do in the postseason. This team is already, we've already won a division. We've already gotten several wild card bursts, you know, underdog. I'll ring here. We've already done all that. All I want to know is how does this team take the next step? What is it that we need to address going forward? I mean, I know last year we didn't even have AJ Green in the lineup and we had no receivers. We were marching out Rex Burkhead to go catch passes in Indy last season, which was just a recipe for disaster. So I'm just wondering what we got to do. You guys let me know.
Well, I mean, I think the biggest, this Bengals team, I think is a victim of their own success right now. I don't think there's anything they're going to do in the regular season that anyone, Bengals fans or national media, is going to give them much credit for. I mean, you know, they've gotten to the playoffs 4 years straight. And so at this point, it's they have to win in the playoffs. I mean, until they win the playoffs, it's just going to be the same storyline amongst Bengals fans, amongst national media. Unfortunately, they can't win a playoff game in the regular season. So, you know, they got to get there first. But, you know, this team has done everything that you really could expect of them in the regular season. At this point, you know, they could go 14-2, but if they don't win that postseason game, it's just going to be the same story of, you know, no one's going to pay attention to them because when it matters, they're not winning.
You know, I noticed that a lot too, and it's really frustrating because if you watch that Eagles-Cowboys game, could you imagine if Andy Dalton went out there and played like Sam Bradford played? What every headline would say.
We've like, seen it all too often.
I mean, God, they would have roasted Marvin. They would have been calling for Marvin Lewis' job. Andy Dalton is a bust. All of this business. Like, I think I'm a victim of social media because all of my friends are Steelers fans and all their Cowboys fans. I'm the lone Bengals fan amongst all these voices of these story franchises. And these guys, they take me to task because, oh, have you ever won a playoff game? When's the last time you won a playoff game? You weren't even alive the last time they went to the playoffs and won.
So, how many playoff games has Tony Romo won? It's not very many.
One?
Yeah.
And got lucky, actually. One and got lucky. So, I mean, I guess. But I don't know. I don't know what to do with these people because Andy Dalton goes out there and he's a franchise quarterback. He's not the best one out there by far. Fine, I'll give you that. But I'll take him over Alex Smith. I'll take him over. I'll take him over a good portion of the NFC quarterbacks out there, and especially in those dumpster fires they have in the AFC East. Even Ryan Tannehill is just gave a huge contract too. But I don't know. I think I'm getting up on my high horse, and I think I'm really getting upset just even thinking about it because I just watched that crazy game and. The Eagles at home against the backup quarterback could not win a football game. If Andy Dalton would have done that, we would have heard about it for the rest of the 17-week season.
Yeah.
Like, we would have heard about it forever. I really think they just got to relax. And I think once we get this whole thing under wraps, if we can just keep winning, maybe we go 16-0. Maybe that's a little optimistic after three games, but we win every game. Hey. Maybe they start giving us some respect.
Yeah, maybe. Not likely, maybe. Though, Chris.
Of course not. We'll always be the Bengals or the Bungles or whatever the hell they want to call us. But thanks a lot, guys. I love the program. You guys take it easy.
You're the man, Chris. Thanks for calling in.
Hooday.
Hooday. That's Chris from Dayton giving us a ring. Let's go to area code 805. Hi, who's this?
Hey, this is Thomas from San Diego.
Hey, Thomas from San Diego. We've got all kinds of new folks tonight. What's on your mind tonight?
All right, not much. Just was going to talk about this Ravens game a little bit. I get why people think there's, possibility for us to lose. It's the NFL. Obviously, you can lose any game, division game, even more so.
But I don't know how people were that high in the Ravens before the season even started. I don't know. They don't scare me at all. This Bengals team is real good. Offense stacked at every single position. Defense, we have a little bit of holes in linebacker. Hopefully Vontaze comes back playing like he did before, but I'm on the Bengals this year. I think we got a real good shot. The only teams that I would even consider being worried about would be the Patriots and the Steelers' offense. Their defense looks disgusting, but their offense can win a game. What do you guys think?
The Patriots right now, the way they dismantled Buffalo, I thought Buffalo going into that game after knocking off Indy in week one, I thought, wow, maybe Buffalo's going to give them a game. And then what we saw, it wasn't even close. The Patriots are in a class on their own in the AFC. Pittsburgh, I think, is a different story. It depends. If you catch them on a day where Ben is just making bad decisions and not making good throws and holding on to the football longer than he needs to, then, yeah, I think there's a chance you can beat the Steelers. Because you're right. Defensively, they've got holes there. You know, they don't have Polamalu back there anymore. They lost Dick LeBeau. They've got a new defensive coordinator. They've got, you know, I think they're older at linebacker. They're not the youngest bunch on defense. So I'm with you. I think if you can outscore the Steelers, great. The problem is it doesn't happen very often, especially when, you know, Andy Dalton goes up against them. So if you look at the AFC right now, Scott, there's probably one more team in there. You probably got to throw Denver in there just because they have Peyton Manning. We don't have exactly the best track record against Peyton Manning. Or the Broncos, for that matter. So, Scott, would you agree with him about the fact that the Bengals are one of the best teams in the AFC?
Yeah, I mean, I would argue that the Bengals, you know, as a whole, are the most balanced team in the AFC, possibly the NFL. I think, you know, talent-wise, they're certainly better talent-wise than New England and Denver. If you go up and down the roster, offense, defense, special teams, it really does boil down to Dalton. I think Denver's better than they're playing right now. I think you're going to see them, you know, be up there at the end of the season. New England, not the most talented team, but, you know, you can't count them out. I mean, with Brady and Belichick, they got to be number one. But yeah, I would at this point say the Bengals would be, you know, up there number two or number three right now.
Yeah, I think we both agree with you, man.
I mean, what you guys said is straight right on point. I mean, we always bring up the past. That's always kind of how everything has to go. But, I mean, this team is different. Everyone's already hashed out. Eifert here, all the other weapons. Everyone's been in the system a few years. He's been awesome play calling. I mean, just everything. Dalton does look sharper. He's been successful early before, but he has looked sharper. Yeah, I just think this team, I mean, knock on wood, if they stay healthy, they're going far. Everyone always, you know, dogs us for the playoff thing. Totally get it. We lost four, but I mean, San Diego was the only game we really should have won, had the better team. I mean, young team going into Houston the first 2 years. Last year, we limped into the playoffs. I mean, the fact that they made it to the playoffs at all after all those injuries, I think should have been more of a testament than everyone dogging us for losing the game. But I think this year, let's get it. Then just our real quick interjection, Dre Kirkpatrick and Pac-Man's tackling has been on point. Last game, a lot of missed tackles from a lot of people. Drace had a couple touchdown saving ones, and Pac was unreal the first game. So just want to throw in there on another high note that I haven't heard about.
Yeah, I agree with you. In fact, there was a play, I believe Melvin Gordon was running up the sideline, probably was going to take it to the house, and exactly. Drake came running across the field and shoved him out of bounds. So you're right. That was a big play in the game, man.
Great. But yeah, I mean, just kind of found this guy was doing a great job over here in San Diego. Get basically no Bengal pucks. It was a great challenge, you guys.
Well, the best part is, you know, when we, you know, here in Ohio, we don't get any Bengals coverage on ESPN or NFL Network either. So don't.
Oh, okay.
You're kind of in the same boat as us.
There'd be a little more over there, but right.
Well, the people who live in Cincinnati get the local coverage, but you're right. We don't get no national love. Right. Maybe that'll change if they keep winning, though.
Cool. All right, take it easy, guys.
Appreciate the call. Don't be a stranger. Hooday.
Absolutely. Thanks.
All right, Scott. Let's go to our score predictions for Sunday against the Baltimore Ravens.
I'm torn here, Nick. Before the season, I had this as one of their losses. You know, and I just, with it being Baltimore's home opener, they're a lot tougher at home. You know, I want to pick the Bengals 31-20. I'll do that. I'll go 31-20. I'll just go against my preseason prediction of this being a loss.
So you're picking them to lose again?
No, I'm picking them to win. I'm going against my preseason prediction was they would lose this one.
Gotcha.
I'll go ahead and say they win.
Yeah, I'm looking at our preseason predictions from a few weeks ago, and Mickey was the only one out of the four of us to pick the Bengals to beat Baltimore. But after seeing them go 0-2 and watching them give up a last-minute drive to Derek Carr and the Raiders after we dismantled the Raiders, I'm going with the Bengals win. I'm changing up my prediction as well. I think they win. I think they put up a lot of points on this Ravens defense. I'll say 31, and I'd like to see them just shut down Joe Flacco. I'll say 31-13, Bengals win on Sunday against the Baltimore Ravens. Yeah, I think I'm going to go. I think Baltimore is in a lot of hurting right now. I think the fact they don't have Suggs, they've got questions on offense. Their number one draft pick hasn't even seen the field yet in Perriman. So, I think if you contain Steve Smith and, you know, and Justin Forsett, I think you'll do a good job against Joe Flacco in that offense. That's my prediction. Let's see. Lenny Rolson in the chat room. He says Bengals win 27-17. And if you got some score predictions as well as some good bold predictions and you're watching us live here in the chat, throw them out there. We'll be sure to mention those as well. Should we do some shout outs, Scott, before we get out of here?
Yeah, let's do it. Shout out.
Give me a shout out.
I got a couple week. So I'll give a shout out to two new followers I got this week. I got the Cincy Bengals fan and Sports Gifts and Beyond. I picked up both of those as new followers this week. And then a shout out to one of our normals, Kirk Campbell, and another one, Mark Young. Both gave me get wells through the Twitter sphere. You know, we talk a lot about the negative of social media, and it is filled with a lot of negatives, but you know, there's some positives as well. And to get those nice tweets after surgery of get wells, I'm much appreciated. I'm sure there's a couple others I'm forgetting, but was much appreciated. So thanks, guys, for those.
Good stuff. Well, we're glad to have you back, man. We're glad you're healthy.
Thanks.
My shout out this week is a congratulations to Guy Bicknell. He is in our Patreon Pick'em League, and he was the winner of our $25 cash prize, courtesy of SPNT.tv. So congrats, Guy. He picked 10 out of the 16 NFL games correctly this week, so good for him. So last week was Mike Hudson Sucks. This week it's Guy Bicknell. And again, he's part of the Patreon Pick'em League. If you want to join our Patreon Pick'em League, it's not too late. Support our podcast at spnt.tv/Patreon, and that'll get you access into the Patreon Pick'em League, where you can win weekly cash prizes based on how you do in the Pick'em. We're not doing against the spread or anything. You just got to pick the winners. And good job this week by Guy. He was our number one picker of the week. If you want to shout out here on the program, again, support our Patreon campaign. You can also send me a tweet. I'm at Nick Seuberling. Where can they hit you up on Twitter at, Scott?
At Scott Bantel.
Awesome stuff. Final thoughts as we wrap up episode 213, Scott?
Well, I just think this is a huge game for the Bengals. You know, I think it's a great opportunity. It's an opportunity for them to bury one of their division rivals 3 weeks into the season. You know, I thought this would be a three-team race in the division, one of those teams being Baltimore, and I think the Bengals can knock the Ravens out with a win. So, huge game this weekend, a huge game leading into a very difficult part of the schedule. So, looking forward to seeing what goes on Sunday.
It's going to be a fun one. I can't wait to watch. Of course, I'll be stuck at a soccer tournament all weekend for both my kids, so I'll be watching tape delayed. Frown face if you're watching here. Yeah, sad face for Subs. maybe that's the secret hashtag of the week, sad face Subs. But yeah, I think they're going to win big. I'm really looking forward to the game. Can't wait to watch it this weekend, and really looking forward to catching back up with you all next week as we recap what happened in that game. If you want to, again, if you want to watch us live, we broadcast this show live every Wednesday night at 9 o'clock Eastern here at cincyjungle.com. We heard from some new folks tonight, Brian down in North Carolina, Thomas out in San Diego, and we'd love to hear from you. So check us out again, Wednesday at 9 Eastern at cincyjungle.com. But of course, as always, if you can't make the live show, we do podcast the audio and video of the show on demand. You can check us out in iTunes, anywhere you can find podcasts. You can find Inside the Jungle. We haven't had an iTunes review in quite some time. In fact, Josh Schuster, who called in tonight, is the last person to leave us an iTunes review, and that was all the way back in May. So if you are listening to us on iTunes and you want to leave some feedback and tell the world how great this show is, we would really appreciate some iTunes love as well. We did miss Mickey this week and Anthony. Hopefully we'll have them back next week and get their thoughts on hopefully a 3-0 Bengals team. I think that's about it. Am I missing anything else, Scott? It's time to go, right?
Yeah, I mean, now that Brandon Tate's officially on the team, we don't get the Brandon Tate countdown to kickoff, no. So I guess there's nothing else.
Yeah, and he's crushing it on those punt returns, let me tell you.
Are we doing our bold predictions?
Nah, we kind of scratched that for this year.
Fair enough.
My bold prediction is that they win big. So, yeah.
We'll take it.
As always, got to thank our associate producers, Andy Lanham, Larry Rolston, Mike Vardy, Fado Bayari, and Josh Schuster as well for their supports of Inside the Jungle. Inside the Jungle is an SPNT production. For more information about our other podcasts, log on to SPNT.tv. And of course, check out our amazing Bengals content over at CincyJungle.com. So for Scott, AC, Mickey, I'm Subs. We'll see you next Wednesday, Bengals fans, for Inside the Jungle. Hooday, everybody.
Good day.